Hello, everybody. At the outset, I thank President of BOS, my friend, Dr. Bijendra Singh, President-elect, Professor Amit Tolat, and Secretary, Dr. Sunil Garg. Let me share my screen. This is my presidential theme. Atmanirbhar Orthopedics, Self-Sufficient, Indian at Heart, Global Incompetence. The topic I have selected for this meeting is 10 Commandments to Predict Successful Outcome with Intramedullary Hip Implants. Recently, I wrote an editorial for Indian Journal of Orthopedics on the same topic. This is a very busy slide. Let me take each point one after the other. I'll go to the first point last. The foremost important thing is good anterior reduction, which is very, very important because anterior cortex is the one which we can see. Posterior cortex is badly comminuted, we cannot see. So anterior cortical reduction is very, very important. This is the Siam picture, which shows the anterior cortex, but you cannot see the posterior cortex. Anterior cortex breaks less like a tibial condyle, it splits, whereas the posterior cortex is like the lateral tibial condyle, which gets comminuted. So reducing posterior cortex is difficult. If you reduce the anterior cortex, it's like the first button of your shirt. The last button or the posterior cortex will also come in alignment properly. Here in this case, you can see the reduction is not proper. When you reduce the fracture, there should be 100% overlap in this fashion. Even if there is a loss of 25% reduction, there is 25% reduction in the posterior cortex also. That is what has happened in this case. This is a very old slide of 2007. While I was operating a very displaced fracture, I reduced the anterior cortex by pushing percutaneously with the Steenman pin. Once the reduction was obtained, I fixed the fracture with the K-wire, then made an entry for the nail. So I have been using this technique for the last 15 odd years, and without it has given me beautiful results. This is an X-ray with a displaced lateral picture. I'm inserting intrafocally a Steenman pin, manipulating, and once the reduction is obtained, fixing with two K-wires which are very anteriorly placed so that they will not come in the way of the nail or the snake screw. Then once the fracture is fixed, without the worry of going into varus, we can adduct the limb, which makes the life of the surgeon easy for passing the nail. So much of adduction is possible in these cases. I even fix undisplaced fracture also with K-wire, because if you don't fix the fracture, when we use the centering awl, superiorly the fracture opens into varus. This article of 2015 by Tang talks about the displaced fractures neck where they use a Steenman pin to fix the fracture, which have been using for more than 15 years, probably from 2003 or 4, I am using. This is in 2005, I did the demonstration surgery at Aurangabad, where I used the technique of fixing the fracture with two wires before I made an entry. These are the two K-wires I'm fixing before I had made an entry. This was an undisplaced fracture. Even an undisplaced fracture like this, this is at the end of the surgery, I used this technique. The next one is good medial reduction. In a subtrochanteric fracture where the compression process are going through medial aspect, we should reduce it beautifully. I don't mind fixing them with wires in this fashion. For intertrochanteric fracture, this article talks about negative, neutral, and positive cortical support, which is very, very important to understand. This is a negative cortical support with the beak going into the distal medial canal. This is a neutral cortical support. And this is a positive cortical support where the beak is coming out of the distal medial canal. We should try to get either the neutral or the positive cortical support. Some clinical pictures of the X-rays, negative cortical support, neutral cortical support, and a positive cortical support. Positive cortical support should be not only in AP, but also in lateral. This is a beautiful positive cortical support in AP, but if you analyze the lateral picture, you can see that there is intussusception of the neck within the distal medial canal that will lead to failure like this. So that is the reason why positive cortical support or at least neutral cortical support should be there even in lateral view also, not just in AP. If there is an avulsion of the lesser trochanter, one should try to get additional 5 to 10 degrees of valgus. Otherwise, though here it is a neutral cortical support, you can see that the beak has slipped into the distal medial canal. This was an old case of 2010. One of my friend was operating. I was not happy when I saw this picture when I joined him. Beak had gone into the medial canal. I just used a bone hook, pulled the neck out, and the beak I got reduced beautifully and inserted a nail. As you can see, this is a very badly comminuted fracture, just fixed properly with two screws with the head and neck. I didn't address any of the other comminution. At 4 months, you can see nice consolidation around the implant in this fracture. This is a 75 AD with a valgus reduction. You can see positive cortical support at 14 months. Beautifully, the fracture has consolidated without any problem. The next one is entry. Entry has to be proper. Though carefully middle the nail, we take the entry from the tip of the trochanter, but the bone is weak on the outer side. We inadvertently try to ream the lateral cortex in this fashion. So that will lead to varus position of the implant or the fracture going to varus, as you can see in this animation. That should be avoided by taking a proper entry. Passing the nail to the fracture side, just because there is a intertrochanteric fracture at the entry, we should not pass the nail without properly reaming and making a space for that. Otherwise, this implant acts as a spacer and that will distract the fracture surfaces. So always one should make a proper canal for the nail before passing the nail. Even in elderly osteoporotic fractures, I use this 10 millimeter curved awl to take out 10 millimeter of bone, then I ream with a centering awl. This is a 94-year-old lady. Recently, I operated this patient, and you can see I reduced the fracture, fixed with KYS, then taken entry much more medially, and I'm using this cheese cutter or end cutting instrument and taking a 10 millimeter of bone. Then after taking out 10 millimeter of bone, then I have passed the guide wire and reaming with a 15 millimeter centering awl, because the nail I use has a proximal diameter of 15 millimeter. So making an entry for the nail or the space for the nail by properly reaming, even in osteoporotic fracture, is very, very important. Never shovel the nail through the fracture site. So this is the same lady walking comfortably with such a beautiful reduction and nice placement of the implant, as you can see on the X-rays. The sixth point is position of the screw. In AP, it should be in the center or slightly inferior to the center. In lateral, it should be posterior or slightly posterior. The next point is tip apex distance. Since I advocate two screw system, as well as I use the inferior screw as kissing the calcar as possible. So if I measure the TAD from fovea centralis, it will be more. So one should measure from the calc TAD, which is the extrapolation of the screw. If I measure the calc TAD, it will be acceptable. In a two screw system, both the screws should be at the same horizontal level. If they are one is longer and one is shorter, or both are equal, then they will lead to trouble. Why they should be at the same horizontal level? Both should take the load simultaneously so that they can slide simultaneously. This article by Julia Henschel talks about different screw lengths and how they work. This is an in vitro study done where they have come to a conclusion that smooth sliding and least varus malformation happens if both the screws are at the same horizontal level. So this is an example of both screw at the same horizontal level. When the hip is loaded, the vector of the forces passes through the neck, head and neck, through the neck screws, and the screw will slide out without any stress within the nail. If there is a inferior screw shorter and superior screw is longer, and what happens is the superior screw takes the load totally, and the vector forces will be more of varus malformation forces. This is especially very common, especially if there is a medial void or the lesser trochanter avulsion and the inferior screw is not having a good subchondral purchase. What happens is, due to varus force, the inferior screw slides out. And this superior screw taking the whole load causes the jamming of the screw within the nail, so it won't slide out and it starts penetrating inside, leading to Z effect. So this is very, very important to have both screw at the same level. The next point is traction should be very well compressed so that the screw heads which is touching the lateral cortex will remain at that site even after the fracture unites, as you can see in this case. How I do is I release the foot end traction and compress superior screw and inferior screw alternatively till I am satisfied that the fracture is compressed properly. So this compression is possible with a screw having a head screw system only. None of the newer implants, such a beautiful compression can be obtained. This is an immediate post-operative x-ray, and this is at 4 months. You can see the screw heads are remaining in the same position at the end of the union. This is very, very important because whatever the fracture was requiring to be compressed, I have done it on table. The head of the screw should have support of the bone. This is very, very important. The reason why I'm telling is, I was in Jaipur from 5th to 8th March for the mini IOCon. During that time, one patient was admitted in my own setup and it was operated on 6th March by my assistant. The OT assistant sent me a requirement for ordering the screw where he had mentioned 105 millimeter neck screw. That indicates that in India, for a person or a patient of less than 6 feet tall, 105 millimeter neck screw is not at all required. So immediately I wrote back to Dr. Sachin Kulkarni, my assistant. Today's operated case, my guess is foot end traction is not released before fully tightening the screw. Once I see the post-operative x-ray, let's discuss, I wrote. And 8th March, he shared me the picture. As you can see, the screw heads are not touching the lateral cortex. This is just because the fracture was distracted when the screw was tightened. Unfortunately, this patient also had a negative cortical support in the lateral view. This patient is bound to have a problem subsequently. As expected, at 2.5 months follow-up, you can see the neck screw has broken. The neck screw has broken, and also there is too much of sliding out of the neck screw, which is making difficult for the patient to sleep on that side. I feel that next head of the screw should have a support of the lateral wall. If there is no support like this, what happens is the screw can toggle, and this toggling within the lateral wall leads to loss of purchase of the threads of the screw, and the screw walks off. That is the reason why transcervical fracture has a high failure rate, only treated with a partly threaded cancellous screw. That's why nowadays we replace few of the partly threaded cancellous screw with a fully threaded screw, or even we replace either with a Powell screw or a horizontal screw to prevent unwanted collapse to happen in this fracture. This is very, very important. If the lateral wall is badly comminuted, none of the newer implants can be used to support or which can be used in these type of fractures. Whereas a PFN with the head in the neck screw can be used. The nail itself can act as a lateral wall, and against the nail, you can compress the head and neck and get a beautiful reduction, as you can see in this patient. Another patient, an 85-year-old male with a severe osteoporotic thin cortex, I intentionally pierced the lateral wall, you can see, and the head of the screw is touching against the and resting against the nail. Patient was made to walk without a problem in the immediate postoperative period. At 10 weeks, you can see when the patient has come for follow-up, the screw heads are still touching the nail, and this is compensating for the deficit lateral wall. At 85-year-old, at this age, this patient was not expecting to survive, walk and sit, as you can see the clinically. He was very, very thankful and he was crying. And I got this permission to show this picture to you all. Another 80-year-old lady with a badly comminuted lateral wall. Again, in the same technique I have used, the nail itself as the lateral wall, and the screw heads are touching against the nail against which I have compressed the head and neck. And this is at 1.5 months, and this is at 4 years follow-up. You can see the nail, the implant is holding beautifully, and the lateral wall comminuted has been managed beautifully. This is an interesting case. There is a problem with the medial avulsion of the lesser trochanter, as well as there is comminution in the lateral wall. I was doing this demonstration surgery at Sancheti Hospital in Pune for Pune trauma course. I use, as said earlier, I have done extra valgus reduction so that the beak will never enter into the distal medial canal. And also I have used the head of the screw against the nail, and this has compensated for the lateral wall And at 4 weeks itself, just a month, you can see Dr. Atul Patil, professor and the unit chief of the trauma, sent me this picture showing nice consolidation in this patient. So this is newer implant, where by pushing the sleeve or by tightening and pulling the screw, you can increase the fracture and to retain the set screw within the nail and lock the sliding mechanism. But what happens is that sliding mechanism will not remain like that because there is no head for the screw. So this is, I have beautifully compressed on table and I have inserted the set screw. But if you see immediate post-operative x-ray, there is gap at the fracture site because the back end of the screw, there is no head and it can slide, go within the hole in the bone. Unless there is a stopper like this. Having a head screw is also very, very important. Only with a screw which is having a head, you can manage this badly comminuted lateral wall. And this is only possible with a PFN with a head, which is available in India. Unfortunately, I know due to patent issues, you and Western people, including America, you don't have an access to such implants. None of the newer implants have a head. And that is the reason why if there is a problem with the lateral wall, this implant requires additional support and additional management. So whereas with a PFN, even if there is a badly comminuted lateral wall, one can manage. The ninth point is nail at the entry site should be slightly out. Otherwise, it can migrate medially, as you can see, or it can toggle, lead to failure of the implant. This can be built up by end cap of different size. In a headless screw, which I normally don't use or advocate to use, one has to keep the back end of the screw slightly out so that they can slide out. If it is inside, they will get jammed and penetration chances are very, very high. So this has happened with me only. I was using a ZNN type of nail where after compression, after releasing the traction, when the post-operative picture is taken, you can see the back end of the screw has gone inside and this patient really had some trouble in the subsequent period. Why the back end of the screw should be out? Because it can slide out when the hip, the fracture collapses because you cannot compress this fracture with this type of implant beautifully as with a PFN with a head. So with this, if it is inside the lateral cortex, it can get jammed. It will not slide out leading to penetration. So this is an example. One of my friend, Professor Joydeep Das from Burdwan Medical College shared me. He was concerned, a 65-year-old lady where he had used a PFNA, it had crossed the safety limit within the head. And he asked me what to do. Then I wrote him back saying that since the back end of the helical blade is outside, so don't worry, there is good chances that it will penetrate outside. It will slide outside. And as expected, this is on 5th September, he showed 6 weeks post-operative, the screws have slided out without any penetration and happy Teacher's Day. So one should learn to predict the outcome by knowing the deficiency in your surgery or having understood all these points. Last one is good implant. In India, we have spurious companies which manufacture many implants of substandard quality. Here you can see the interlocking is near the tip. Here you can see there is no tapering of the nail, which is required. Even the screw heads are not proper. A good PFN will have a tapering end so that the stress distribution happens. The distal locking is done about 1.5 inch away so that stress distribution happens. And there is good metal around the neck screw so that the nail will not bend or break at that site. Here you can see a thinner nail with a thick screws. It has broken in due course of time. So having a good implant of known company is also very, very important. Finally, to conclude, good outcome if all the 10 points which we have discussed are taken care during surgery. This is an 86-year-old male. This is an 86-year-old male. And 26th of July, this patient had come to me and this patient was operated at Baramati. He was the uncle of an orthopedic surgeon, Dr. Vinay Shah. And you can see there is a combination as well as thin lateral wall. Because of the lesser trochanter was avulsed, I got an additional extra valgus in this patient. This is the 2 months you can see good consolidation. The greater trochanter was also broken, but it was a fairly in position, so I didn't do anything. Yesterday, when I went to Baramati for doing another surgery in another 82-year-old patient, this patient came to felicitate me. I took this opportunity to take an X-ray. You can see beautifully this has consolidated and the neck shaft angle has almost the normal, like the opposite side. This is on the picture with the patient felicitating me with the orthopedic surgeon, Dr. Vikram Dobade, and orthopedic surgeon, Dr. Vinay Shah at Baramati on 8th of July. So this is the same patient walking unsupported. So he walks outside with stick, but he is able to walk in the house without any support. Right leg has been operated in this patient. This patient already I have shown, elderly 93-year-old lady, beautifully reduced fracture. All the 10 points have been taken care. The patient is walking comfortably without any problem. So one should learn to predict the outcome by knowing all these points. So that is what I wanted to share with you all. Once again, I thank Professor Dr. Vijayendra Singh for this opportunity given to me for sharing my experience